Of accepted what the meaning of the truth of our heart. Yes. Can somebody read with me Psalms 45, verse 1? Psalms 45, verse 1 from the Good News Bible. A good person is the person that has a good treasure. And so what is a good treasure? A good treasure is any value that is beneficial to humanity. And a bad treasure is anything that is distracting and self-defeating to ourselves. And because I said a treasure is something that is carefully stored, Jesus said that because you cannot, those of us that have, those of you that have treasure, you see that you don't place it just anywhere. It is hidden. So that nobody gets access to it. It is hidden. You see that those that have jewelry, it is where the children will not have access to. The same way that our treasures are hidden, Jesus said, in our hearts. And so it is difficult for people to get access to it. It is only you. Psalm 45, there's one thing that can you help it? Psalm 45. Yes.
I adapt my writing to the king. My tongue is like a pen of a ready scribe. Amen.
Amen. So you see that the psalmist is saying that.
Let me read my good news Bible.
Beautiful words fill my heart, and I compose this song for the king. Like the pen of a good writer, my song is ready for the poet. There are four things that we can think of. The tune of his heart. The tune of your heart is the subject of your heart. There are some people you easily identify them with the topic. There are some people, anything they talk about, you know. Somebody says that when I come here, he knows I'm going to talk about money.
Praise the Lord.
What do you talk of? What is the subject of your heart? Most of the time, when you are watching Nigerian movie, you know that this one will end in somebody getting married to somebody. From the start, the moment credit start coming, and a man helps a woman, or a woman helps, oh my God, somebody is going to get married to somebody at the end of the day. So they say that there is a team. There is a team. For Nigerian movies, and most of the time it's love. What is the subject of your heart? When back in the days, you know that the subject of American movies are distraction. It's shooting. They will destroy everything. And so when you are frustrated, you go and get American movie and you want to destroy it. Praise the Lord. There are some musicians that have love teams, and every song they write is about love. There are some musicians, every song they write is about rejection.
Hey. Lord Jesus.
Praise the Lord. So the question this morning is that, what do people know you of? What is the subject of your heart? It is very important, because I've said that the subject of your heart is derived from the treasures of your heart. What you have stored, what you have placed value on in your heart will determine what you talk about.
When sometimes when you become so angry, when the subject of your heart becomes angry, all you see around you is anger. Even the weatherman on TV is just horrible. He comes to read the news and you are angry.
Hey.
Somebody drives his new Range Rover and you are angry. Somebody is in his new pair of shoes and you are angry. That becomes the subject of your heart. And there are some people, any conversation you pick up with is about money. They see money in every conversation. Take them to anywhere and they see money. Praise the Lord. They see opportunities where when people are wondering what are you talking about, they see it. That is the subject of their heart. There are some people, the subject of their heart is anxiety and fear. They always think people are looking out to pounce on them.
And they are so suspicious of other people. I think somebody is looking at me. Whatever I'm doing, I think somebody is looking at me. They are so engrossed with fear. And if you bring fear in everything, they get a mail. And they ask, how did these people get my name? Somebody might be tracking me. Praise the Lord. When you have a subject of your heart, your mind opposes it. What you think of, the brain is such that the more you think of something, the more you get a composition of it. And so I believe that if you are thinking so much and meditating on so much on a particular subject, people we call paid funeral guides. We pay people to cry at funeral. And those people, when they are crying, my God, the kind of cries they will say with passion. Meanwhile, they don't have any relation to the person that is dead. And sometimes you wonder, how do these people come out with such words? It is because that is the subject of your heart, and the mind composes words for it. Have you heard somebody that says that, me, I can insult you and you will die? Have you heard somebody like that? They say that some people have the cause for insulting. They can really give it to you and you will be there, my God. Why did I even go into the trap of this place? They will make you useless. It is because that is the subject of your heart. Anything you talk about, like the who was asking me, you think, oh, how do you know that you have to go and buy this software and do that? Because that is the subject of my heart. And when I want to do something, and I'm searching, Bible says that seek and you shall find. Because I am engrossed with this topic and I'm searching and I'm doing so much with it, God will direct you. And the mind will propose. Praise the Lord. In Psalm 45, the latter part says that my tongue is ready with the pen to write a poem. There is a secret. The treasures of your heart will give you the theme of your heart. The theme of your heart will give you the composition. And the composition will give you a declaration and then the Lord. All these things will come into connection to the purpose of God in our life. Praise the Lord. So this morning I'm asking this question again, what is the theme of your heart? It is very important because as Christians we are privileged. I like to listen to motivational messages. There is this guy, Brown, in the U.S. I like listening to him. Every morning, I take one at a tail. Do you listen to things that will take you up high? I know that advice from our parents, somebody has said that our generation, we are not too close, we are not too far from the Bush generation. I mean, not American Bush, but village generation. In the sense that some of us, it takes it just one generation to find that our parents were from the Bush. Mm-hmm. So you see that me, it is my grandmom that left the Bush, and my mom came to the city, and I was there. So it takes me just two generations to take me back to the bush. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? There are some that will just take them just one generation, and you see that their mom and dad are still in the bush. There are some, it will take them about four generations. You see that they were lucky. Their father or grandfather was a civil engineer or civil worker, teacher, and then their parents became lawyers, and then they are okay. But if you go back four, it will still end up in the bush. What I'm trying to say is that because of that, our mentality of greatness is not in line. Come to the West and you see that people saw greatness in the 10th century. Way back. And so when they are telling their children, you can make it, the children will tell you, I know. Very simple to align themselves with faith. For us, our parents will tell you, Fabra, you know we are poor. No, we are poor. So please, whatever you are doing, do you know how? I mean, think about yourself. You know we don't want trouble. And so when God gives you an idea and you want to even step out, that mentality, think of yourself, I mean, no trouble. You kind of step back. Praise the Lord. So you see that the kind, that is why the youth, you need to step up, because I will not be naive. We as parents, we are underachievers. And so it is difficult for you to break through the ceiling. But I pray that God will help you.
Amen.
To be able to break through the ceiling and be your greatness. Some of us, I don't think my mom has seen £20,000 cash or in the account before. And so if I should tell my mom I want to see £1 million.
Talk things that you can manage. You know what I'm talking about. So we need to step up. We need to step up. Praise the Lord. I want to
talk about the external things quickly and then we do. The external things that will make you connect to the purpose of God into your life. These are the business we looked at. God in your life, you have to monitor the tune of our heart by determining what goes into the center of our heart. So you need to connect the purpose of God. Monitor what is the tune of your heart. And you can only monitor what is the tune of your heart by determining what God will help us have a very good value on things that are important, things that will bring benefit to the human race. Amen. In the lecture, we want Luke 1:47. God has given you that passion. God has given you that dream for the ministry. God has placed that burden on you. You need people that will understand you. And these people are called the external force. This is a young man about, a young woman about 16 years of age. Preparing to get married. Then all of a sudden, something appears to her and tells her, you will get pregnant. Of course, it is normal. Every girl that is going to get married will get pregnant. It is normal. But then, the Holy Spirit the Holy Spirit. This, anytime
very serious thing for marriage speaking. What kind of a spirit impregnates young women? Do you? No, I mean, think about it. She's a very young, young lady preparing to get married. And you tell me you'll be pregnant, but not by your husband, but by the Holy Spirit. And it has not happened before. So what kind of a spirit is pregnant young women? It's kind of dream. Anyway, the Bible says that Mary accepted it in him, and then she gets pregnant. If it were you, I mean, who would even believe your report? Who would believe your report? Do you want to bring an honor to the family?
Hey.
Nobody will even trust you. Nobody will believe your report. And this is the kind of thing that when God gives to you, when you keep it to yourself, you go clean. When you tell people you tell you are clean, have you been in a position where God has put something in your heart, a passion in your heart, and nobody understands you?
Tell it.
Nobody understands you. It is only you who understand yourself. Some people call you foolish. Yes, because it is not there. It is only you who believe Mary. And who will trust the report of Mary? That is the most frustrating thing in the world. When you have a passion and nobody understands. And he stopped his way. And then he went to his friend brother and said, Joseph, this is what God is telling me to do, and so I quit my job. And he said his brother looked straight in his head and said, well, you have a wife and children, and you say you stop your job.
Who is going to feed them? But sometimes it takes a foolish person to understand.
It's not everybody who should be. There are some people, they are too organized. They are too wise. And they will not understand you. What I'm trying to say is that for you to connect to the purposes of God in your life, you need an Elizabeth in your life. I don't mean... I don't mean the Bible either. But you see... After Mary was troubled and she was thinking she was going crazy. The Bible says she went to Elizabeth. She went to Elizabeth. And after her interaction with Elizabeth,
the Bible says that she exclaimed, "My soul magnifies the Lord."
And I was just thinking that after explaining yourself to somebody and somebody says, "Just Jacob, I believe in this. At least I'm not crazy."
Mm-hmm.
Somebody understands me.
You need somebody to understand you.
Yes.
You need somebody that has walked the way you are walking.
Mm.
And it's not just anybody.
Mm.
Mary traveled a long distance to meet Elizabeth. There are some times that you have to speak to people that have tread the way of your vision. If you are going to become a pharmacist, don't come and speak to me. That is the truth. Unless the Holy Spirit directs you to do so. Because I've got no clue about it. And so when you tell me, there is nothing to give you. But you see, Elizabeth had already had the visitation of the Lord. And as a matter of fact, the husband went to work. He went to do his daily priesthood activity.
Came back home down. And against all odds, the woman got pregnant over her menopause. And so you see that Elizabeth has tasted the craziness of God.
And so when Mary came, and Mary
was explaining these things, the craziness of God to Elizabeth, Elizabeth had some connection, understanding of what is happening. And so she said, how come the Savior of my Lord will pay me a visit?
Wow.
You see, Elizabeth made Mary
have a peace of mind. And so connect to somebody that will say your baby. Not just anybody. And I think find somebody that has faith that will be born. Somebody that will not be intimidated by what God has revealed to you. The brothers of Joseph became intimidated by what God has revealed to Joseph. Speak to somebody that has prayed the way that you want to pray. Praise the Lord. My brother, come over to Peterborough. I have done this and I've done that and I've done that. You can make it bigger than even what I'm thinking. I said, my God, so I'm not crazy. I am not crazy. He's somebody that I can relate to because he was not born with you. He came from Cameroon. He has been able to achieve what I want to achieve. And he's telling me now he has. Excuse me to use the word, but white people working for him, he's the only CEO. And if you go to check Peterborough FM, he's a guy that has only white employees. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And he said, come over, you can even do better than I'm doing. And I'm thinking, my God. Praise the Lord. You need somebody that will not be intimidated by your vision. Can you imagine Mary telling a wrong person about the pregnancy of Jesus?
Hey.
Can you imagine? My friend, aborting this one.
Aborting this will bring disgrace.
It's true.
This one should be a secret between me and you.
Hey.
You go and abort this secret, and this one I won't tell anybody. You can't have this baby. This one, ooh, me and you. Mary, if you don't do it, you will bring disgrace to the family. You have to. Can you imagine sharing your vision? There are some people who are dream killers.
Say that again. Tell it.
And so you don't have to say it with just anybody. If Mary had shared the vision with just anybody, you would still, I don't know if God would allow me, but if Mary had decided to abort the baby, you would have done it anyway. You could have done it. And I don't know if Jesus could have been killed. It is a mystery. But that is the truth. Share your vision with people that will not be intimidated. And kill your vision. Praise the Lord. Share your people with people that will accept your vision. And the last thing, very serious, the awakens you
and puts you at ease. the
the thing of Jesus.